to soften my heart and break me apart. I need you to open my eyes and see that you're shaping my life. All I am, I surrender. Give me faith to trust what you All right, good morning. Thank you for joining us online. Welcome to The Crossing at BCC Online. My name is Jeff Henson. I'm the lead pastor here, and so thankful that you made a decision to join us this morning. I want to encourage you to to chat. We've got someone that's moderating things, and so feel free to comment, interact with each other as you watch the service this morning. A couple things we hit every week. If you're a first time guest with us, is that we have the social media places that you can visit us to find more about who we are, what we're about, and what we're doing in this community, in this world. So whether it's Facebook, whether it's our website, thecrossingatbcc.com, or whichever one that you choose, go there. You'll be able to get more information about what's happening here at the Crossing of BCC. Also want to let you know, if you came prepared to give this morning, is that if you go to thecrossingatbcc.com/give, it will give you options to be able to give online, to be able to mail in a check, or even able to do the text give, which you see over my shoulder. I just want to say thank you so much for all of you who have generously and faithfully given over the last several months. To be honest, it's been a crazy blessing, and that's definitely something we were concerned with as this was all happening, and we're really blown away by your faithfulness and giving. So thank you for giving to the mission and ministry of the Crossing at BCC. Also want to let you know, communion is going to happen at the end of service, and so this is kind of your warning to go grab your cracker, grab your juice, and be prepared for that. That will be after the message. A couple things we want to remind you of that are happening. Item of the month is one of them. We are partnering with the Bixby Outreach Center, and there are a few items that they need as their shelves have really been kind of drained, and we want to do our best as a church to be able to support them as they're trying to meet the needs of families, not only in Bixby, really in this whole South Tulsa County area. And so we have a collection bin in the lobby, and if we need to be able to figure out how to arrange a time, if you haven't been coming in person, we can do that. We can figure that out. But we have a collection bin out there where we're collecting box cereals, canned pasta, and hearty soups. And those are the three items. We'll be doing it through the entire month of September. We'd love for you to join us and be able to bless them as they are doing their best to bless others. Also, I want to let you know that our groups are going to be starting at the end of September. And our groups ministry, man, it is so critical to be able to have people in your life. We believe circles are greater than rows. We believe that life change happens in the best in the context of community. And so we have some different options we're rolling out. And so we're going to have online groups. They'll be meeting on Sunday nights. We'll have on-campus groups. They'll be meeting on Wednesday nights. And then we'll also have home groups that will be meeting on Sunday nights. And I almost forgot, but we have a college and young adult group that meets on Tuesday night. And so there are different options for you to go. If you go to thecrossingatbcc.com, you can find more information about those groups. You can actually fill out a form and sign up for one of those groups. It has detailed information when they're meeting. We want you connected. It's a difficult season that we're in, and we're trying to offer a variety of ways, whether it's online or in person, to be able to stay connected and build community with one another. And last but not least, just want to remind you that the Rooted Student Ministry is back at it. Wednesday nights, 6:30. I know last week was their launch, but if you're a 6th through 12th grader or have a 6th through 12th grader, definitely encourage you to get them there. It's the type of environment you want your student in. And so that's happening this Wednesday night. Well, we're continuing week two of Boiling Point, and I'm going to pray for us, and we'll roll into the message. God, we give you this day. We ask that you would be glorified through the message, through the service, through this church, God. We ask, Lord, that you would stir our hearts towards your word, that we would be open to what you want to say to us today. God, move in our midst. May the power of your word and the power of your spirit change us. In Jesus' name.
Carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. Yeah, I see it now.
Good morning. My name is Jeff Henson. I'm the lead pastor here at the Crossing of BCC. Thank you for joining us online today. However you find us, wherever you find us, honestly, we count it as a privilege that you would take time out of your Sunday and find us online, and we hope that you are challenged and blessed. For us as a church, our mission is to help people find and follow Jesus. And so if you're already following Jesus, we pray that you are challenged and that you are pushing your faith. If you are maybe on a quest for Jesus, have a lot of questions, have doubts, just trying to work things out, we're okay with that as well. Thank you for just really surrendering yourself to the process. We want to create a safe and grace-filled space for you to be able to bump into Jesus a little more each time that you join us. Now, for those of you who are following our weekly check-in that me and Dusty were doing during the beginning of the pandemic, you should know my love for memes. And so I found a meme this week and thought it really kind of spoke to where we've all been the last several weeks. I'm going to go ahead and show it on the screen here. It says this: I can't believe it's almost September. Literally feels like it was March just 16 years ago, right? I mean, that's kind of where we're at. Feels about right, right? I mean, goodness, what a ride that we've been on the last several months. It's been 6 months that feel like when I used to go to Bell's, and I don't know if you know Bell's Amusement Park back in the day, had this ride like the Himalaya, and somehow I got tricked to go on this ride with my parents, and I will never forget, as the ride began, I am at my parents' feet screaming that they would stop this ride. And at the moment that I think, and if you've wrote it, you know what's coming. At the moment that you think it's over, and I'm like, oh, thank goodness, it begins to go backwards and faster and faster. But like, that is how this last 6 months, honestly, has felt for me and probably has felt for you. I mean, it's the reason that why we're doing this series. Is because this season of life has brought forth so many emotions, so many feelings, so many struggles, and so many challenges that it's brought many of us to the boiling point. And so we're taking a few weeks to look at what God says about how to navigate such a difficult season that we're all experiencing together. Now, I'm sure you've seen some of these stickers on cars running around town. We've got the 13.1 one right there, yeah. Then we've got the 20.6.2. Now, those of you who don't know, this is marathon. They've run a marathon. 13.1 is half marathon. I like this 13.1 one is kind of the little bit of a different one. It says, I only want half. I think it's like, I only want half. Yeah, I'm only half crazy on this. And then you have a couple others that are a little more my speed. Let's go ahead and go. There you go. 13.1 hours, my longest Netflix binge. And then we have a 26.2 Oreos I've eaten in one sitting. Some of you are like, yes, that one belongs on my car. But my favorite and the most accurate for my life, period, is this next one. 0.0, I don't run. Listen, if I ran a marathon, by the way, I would be putting stickers all over the place, but I haven't and I won't, so it's irrelevant, right? But here's why I bring that up, because my wife has actually ran a couple of marathons, has ran several half marathons, one in the rain, one when her partner hurt her ankle in the last several miles, and so they had to get through that together. And let me tell you, as just an observer, it's exhausting to watch. I was tired. I should have just ran a marathon. I was exhausted running back and forth, trying to be able to cheer her on and trying to be the good husband on that day. But watching all these people exert so much energy was exhausting. Now, at the beginning of every race, every marathon, if you've been to one, you know this, the enthusiasm and the energy at the starting line is crazy. People have been training for this for several months. Family and friends are at the starting line cheering their significant people in their life on. There's crowds of people, there's style and there's fashion. People, you know, have different outfits, different things like that. I mean, everyone is pick ready, worthy. I mean, it is a fun environment. No one quits at the starting line. Everyone is full of optimism and hope at the starting line of a marathon. Now, then you get to mile 16 or 17. It's a little rougher. And let's just say at this point, the excitement is gone. The optimism is fading. The why am I doing this question begins to creep in. Then somewhere around the 20-mile mark, the dreaded and infamous wall hits. And the wall is this common term that is used for runners. And it means when everything is depleted at that place. And when you find yourselves hitting the wall, you have choices to make, right? And if you've ever went to a marathon race, this is why you will see so many people with signs, a lot of clever and creative signs, a lot of signs in mile marker 19 to 23, because that is it right up in the middle of the wall. They actually have graphs to show when people quit in marathons, and the mile marker between 19 and 23 have the highest percentage of quitters during that period of the race. And it's a time in the race that becomes a blur. It's a time in the race where you just have to hang on. It's a time in the race when you doubt things, when you're mad about things. There are a lot of different emotions and thoughts swirling around in that wall period. You either push through or you quit. And runner or not, there are so many things about a marathon that I believe are relevant and applicable to our faith journey. One being that our faith journey is not a sprint. It's a long run. It's a marathon. That is bad news for someone like myself who hates running, right? But the most obvious one is that throughout life, you and I will hit many walls along the way. Many seasons, many opportunities, many events that we will either push through or we will quit. Many seasons and situations that require a spiritual perseverance to push through things. And last week we talked about patience. This week we're talking about perseverance. In the simplest of definitions, perseverance is the ability to continue a course of action in spite of difficulty or opposition. I'm going to read that again. Perseverance is the ability to continue a course of action in spite of difficulty or opposition, meaning continuing to run the race even when challenges come, continuing to chase after a calling when frustration and disappointment hit your life, to continue to live in obedience when roadblocks and unforeseen feelings and seasons visit, the ability to continue a course of action in spite of difficulty or opposition. And here's the thing, we all have been created with the capacity to persevere. The root word of perseverance in the Greek actually means this, through severity, which speaks to pushing through when severe things happen externally or internally. There's a young theologian named Dora the Explorer. You may have heard of her. She knew this without knowing it. There would always be moments in the show when she would say this when a roadblock occurs. Can't go over it. Can't go under it. Can't go around it. Gotta go through it. And the Apostle Paul speaks to going through it, through the severe stuff, in Romans chapter 5, verse 3 and 4. And it says this, not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And the Apostle Paul says, we can rejoice in our trials and struggles. We can embrace them because they will produce some fruit within us. They will produce perseverance. They will produce something that is useful and constructive and profitable for a follower of Jesus. And in this chain of growth and development in this text, perseverance is the catalyst. It is the launch point, isn't it? And God is telling us that when we don't push through, when we don't work through difficult moments and seasons and situations, is that we are robbing ourselves of growth. We are robbing ourselves of character development. We are short-circuiting and sabotaging an inner transformation that God desires to do within us. I know we've mentioned this verse in the past few weeks, but it's too good to let lie, and it speaks to the fruit of perseverance. And the writer of James writes this in James 1, 2 through 4. He says, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything." I love that. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature, so that you may be complete, so that you may not lack anything in your life. And so we see that spiritual maturity comes out of perseverance. We see that contentment comes out of perseverance. We see that wholeness and spiritual completion are fruit and byproducts of seeing things through for those who persevere. And perseverance is necessary for followers of Jesus to produce God-honoring character in our lives. Perseverance is necessary for a follower of Jesus to be able to see that God-glorifying fruit and to be able to have a seasoned and mature faith. Listen to what the late and great preacher Charles Spurgeon wrote about this. He said this: "Faith untried may be true faith, but it is sure to be little faith. And it is likely to remain dwarfish so long as it is without trials. Faith never prospers well as when all things are against her. Her tempests are her trainers and lightnings are her illuminators. No flowers wear so lovely a blue as those which grow at the foot of the frozen glacier. No stars gleam so brightly as those which glisten in the polar sky. No water tastes so sweet as that which springs amid the desert sand. And no faith is so precious as that which lives and triumphs in adversity." You know, I've mentioned on occasion the different kind of CrossFit workouts that I do on a regular basis. And honestly, a lot of those workouts and a lot of the training are purposed to be able to really grow in muscle and cardio, stamina and endurance. And many of these workouts that we do and that maybe I'm even about to do here in a little bit are really to develop the muscles to help them to have a stamina that is stretching, a stamina that allows the muscles and the breathing, the respiratory system to be able to endure, to persevere under strain. And it's interesting because during these sessions, many times, I mean, yesterday I can even think of it, I'm looking for an excuse to leave, right? You're like, does anybody need me right now? I don't want to go through this. But what I've realized that it is actually in those like challenging and straining parts of the workout that those moments, the moments I want to quit, are the moments that lead to greatest growth. It's the severity of feelings, right? The struggle, the perseverance that actually helps my muscles grow and my cardio to grow as well. Let me ask you this morning, what is your normal default when seasons of discomfort, challenges, or uncertainties hit your life? Is perseverance something that comes easy to you or a little more difficult? Is perseverance, maybe perseverance is natural when it comes to other things, but not so much when it comes to faith? I think it's interesting and intentional that the writer of James says to let perseverance finish its work, meaning this: we have a choice to make. We need to give perseverance a green light in our lives. It's almost as if God knew that we have a tendency to quit, that we have a tendency to leave the race. We have a tendency to move onto a dangerous yet comfortable path, right? To leave the uncomfortable one. It's almost like God knew that our sinful and selfish nature would choose, if given the chance, to forgo the blessing, to miss out on the fruit. And I think there are a couple traps that we all face when reaching boiling point status in our lives. A couple traps that can keep us from letting perseverance finish its work within us. And here's trap number one: to give up. To give up. Instead of leaning into what God is wanting to do in our lives, there's a significant trap to resist, to push back, We easily abandon commitments. We neglect priorities. We choose unfaithfulness. We make excuses for disobedience. When we give up, we move on from certain God callings on our life. We begin to orient our lives away from God. We begin to orient our lives away from His Word, away from His church, away from truth tellers. You see, giving up is when we start looking for the easy path. We start looking for the more convenient and comfortable path. The path that doesn't require perseverance to stay on. You know, author Seth Godin has a book called The Dip, and he talks about the power of the dip. And here's a chart that he uses. And you'll see here on one side it says results, then you have effort at the bottom, and then you can see the results go higher outside of the dip. And the premise of this book is he is talking about the impact and the results of those who don't quit and work through the dip. And he writes about how whether it's a new business or a new career or a new project, that at the beginning it's exciting, right? Rah, rah, rah. But you'll always have those seasons, those years, those moments of the dip. And how you respond in the dip will likely determine your future destination. If you keep pressing, you keep working, you keep persevering, then the results on the other side are significantly greater than if you don't. And what he has noticed is that many people get discouraged easily, quickly, and tap out prematurely before fruit of their perseverance pays off. Now, goodness, if that is not the story of many of our spiritual lives. We tap out before the harvest comes. We give up before perseverance finishes its work within us or through us. We do whatever we can do to avoid discomfort, to avoid the pressure of pain, and we sabotage the finished work that God is wanting to do through that very discomfort. And can I tell you something this morning? I wholeheartedly believe this. Spiritual breakthrough is on the other side of the dip. Answered prayers are on the other side of the dip. Spiritual fruit is on the other side of the dip. Moral authority for your life is on the other side of the dip. A testimony is on the other side of the dip. Great strength, great maturity, great perspective, great contentment is on the other side of the dip. Apostle Paul writes this in Galatians 6:9. Let us not become weary in doing good. For at the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we what? If we do not give up. The proper time, we will reap a harvest. The fruit will come. The breakthrough will come if we do not give up. You know, I know when I was doing student ministry a day or two ago, right? It's been a while. But I remember back then, the average youth pastor's tenure at a church was 12 to 18 months. And I would tell youth pastor after youth pastor that I would mentor, if I were just friends with them, I would tell them, you're not going to see any lasting fruit until after year three. You may see some stuff, you may see some splashes, some good moments, but the fruit, the harvest, comes after 3 years. And our tendency and their tendency, when things are tough, we bail. When things aren't like what we hope they'd be, we parachute out. And here's the spiritual action step that counters giving up today, and it's showing up. Don't give up, show up. And let me tell you what showing up is. This is a call to faithfulness in the midst of trying times. It's a call to commitment in the midst of stressful seasons. It's a call to fight the fight courageously in spite of what's happening around you, and I would say in spite of even what's happening within you. Showing up means to faithfully put yourself in environments where God can grow you, where God can comfort you, where God can love you, direct you, and mature you. Giving up is abandoning those environments. Showing up is embracing them even when you don't feel like it, even when it's tough to be there, even in spite of what's happening in your life. So I need to show up. You need to show up to use your gifts to serve God and His church. You and I need to show up to worship with other believers on a Sunday morning. You and I need to show up to community and maybe one of our groups that we're offering here at the church. You need to be in Christ-centered relationships, and you need to show up even when you don't feel like showing up. I need to, you need to show up in environments that will stretch us, that will move us, that will impact our lives. You see, we get this when it comes to exercising, right? I mean, I'm just talking about it a little bit. I mean, I wouldn't even say showing up is more than half the battle. It is the battle, is it not? Just to show up, just to be faithful to show up, even when it's difficult, even when you've had bad food for lunch, right? Even when you're not proud of yourself or something's amiss in your life, you need to show up. You know, some of you have given up in the past. Or maybe you're in a place where you're really considering giving up right now. It's not too late for you to choose to show up. Start making a choice today to get on the other side of the dip, right? To say yes to things you've typically said no to that keeps you in the dip, in the rut, and doesn't help pull yourself out. Trap number one, give up. The spiritual counter is show up. Here's trap number two, give in. When we hit the wall, per se, in our lives and things are difficult, things are stressful, things are uncertain, things are challenging, this is when temptation is the greatest in our lives. I believe it's in these moments it's so easy to have a spiritual pity party. It's so easy to justify missteps. It's so easy to minimize sin or dismiss sin in our lives. And instead of letting perseverance finish its work, we choose to give in to the temptation of sin in our lives. And here's what I would say. I believe we all have a signature sin, a fatal flaw, if you will. And when we're squeezed, we have a greater propensity to give in unless we're fully aware of it and battle it and confront it head on. You see, giving in is accepting compromise as a palatable option. Giving in is justifying obvious disobedience through the lens of the world. Giving in is doing spiritual gymnastics to give ourselves the green light to indulge in sin. Giving in prevents perseverance from finishing its work. And I want you to think, do you know what your signature sin is? And that is not to glorify it or dismiss it or to justify it or to make it lesser than, but do you know what it is? And have you felt that pull and tension within you when things are tough and challenging in your life? You see, the temptation and trap of giving in is why the writer of Hebrews wrote this: therefore, we are surrounded by such great cloud of witnesses, Hebrews 12:1. Let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with what? With perseverance, the race marked out for us. And he's saying to you and to me, you are in a race. God has called you to something unique and specific and extraordinary, but don't lose the possibilities and the potential by giving in to sin. Don't let something or someone cut in on you and rob you, right? Get rid of everything in your life that is going to hinder your ability to persevere in times of pressure. Don't allow sin to sabotage your harvest. Don't allow sin to rob you of the fruit that should be in your life and coming through your life. And here's a spiritual action step that counters giving in, and it's digging in. Don't give in, dig in. Stand firm in your faith. Stand firm in God's word. Stand firm in God's calling on your life. Secure your footing around who God says you are and what God is calling you to. I love the passage, 1 Corinthians 15:58. It says, therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast. Be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. You know, I think of the good old field days that we used to have in elementary, and you would have all the track games and activities that each grade would participate in. And my favorite of all to watch, regardless if I was in the event or not, was the tug of war. And it was just, it's so basic, it's so primal, just loved it. And you'd have, whether it be 10 to 15 kids on each side of, you know, each side represents a class going head to head. And you would always have what I would say a larger than normal kid at the end of each rope, right? And they would have that rope wrapped around their waist. And the really good ones would take some extra time to dig their foot in. So whenever the match began, they would have secure footing. And quite honestly, it would take extraordinary strength and effort for them to get out of the place that they have secured their foot in. When I think about us choosing not to give in, but to dig in, I envision us getting one foot secured in God's words and God's purposes instead of the slippery surface of the world's opinion or the world's standard that many times we place our footing upon. Matthew 4, Jesus was tempted by Satan. And after each temptation, Jesus quoted scripture. He used the word of God to battle the temptations that were being thrown his way. He used the word of God to be his compass during those trying times. He used the word of God to be the sword to battle the twisted lies of the enemy. He used the word of God to solidify and remind him of his mission and his identity. And truth be told, many times we fall and we fall and we fall and we give into the same things over and over again. And many times the reason is that we have no biblical footing. We have not dug in to God's truth for our lives. And here's the action step on this. Beyond digging in, you need to become familiar with God's word. You need to bump up against the truth of God consistently in your life. You cannot live out what has not been brought in. You cannot obey what you do not know. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 says this, all scripture is God-breathed, is breathed out by God, and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, and the man of God, listen to this, may be complete and equipped for every good work. You will be complete, you will be empowered, you will be equipped to be able to take on the world, to be able to persevere, to be able to navigate the feelings, the emotions, the seasons of hardship and trial. You will have everything that you need as a follower of Jesus to get secure footing, to dig in when temptation comes your way. You know, the Apostle Paul says this, regarding temptation, 1 Corinthians 10:13 says, no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind, meaning we're all tempted, right? And God is faithful. I love that because we just talked about don't give up, show up. Listen, God shows up. He's not giving up on you. He shows up. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. Another word for endure is persevere it, so that you can persevere, so that you can endure it. And I would just say this, when you're wanting to give in, look for the open doors and the open lanes that God is providing for you, that is giving you a way out so that you can persevere. And it may be a person, it may be a phone call, it may be a text, it may be a step of obedience, whatever that may look like. But look for it and take it. Here's the deal. When we are in these seasons, these boiling point seasons, a trap to give up, don't give up, show up. A trap to give in, don't give in, dig in. Let perseverance finish its work. And I'll close with this. The Apostle Paul wrote this at the end of his ministry. And I love this. And it's actually 2 Timothy 4:7-8. And I think I put it wrong on the slides, but it says this, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. And my prayer for us is that we can say at the end of our life, because of perseverance, honestly, because we did not give up, because that we did not give in, is, man, the fight that I have fought, the race I have finished, the faith I have kept. And then the beautiful part of this is we receive the crown, which is an emblem of victory, right? This is what we strive for. And let us get to the end of our life not saying, I wish I would have fought the fight of faith. Not saying, I wish I would have finished. I wish I would have kept the faith. I wish I would have run the race well. No, let us say, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. And listen, that comes through showing up, being faithful, and digging in and relying on God's word during difficult times. God, we thank you for the opportunity, Lord. We ask that you would move in our midst. We ask that you would speak to us, convict us, direct us, change us, Lord, as we are watching this. And God, wherever we may be and whoever's watching, what they're feeling and experiencing, help them to be able to identify struggles and challenges in their life and be able to surrender them to you today. And God, we thank you for the opportunity to gather, whether it be online or in person. What a wonderful grace you have given us through that. And God, just ask, Lord, that you would give us exactly what we need to persevere during this time. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to go ahead and move into a time of communion. And if you got your cracker and your juice, we're going to play a song here in a second. And we would just ask that during this time to take a time out, pause, reflect on who Jesus is, not only his life, but his death. And think about the blood that was shed and the body that was broken so that you could experience forgiveness and freedom and be made one with God the Father. You can take communion whenever you're ready.
You are here, moving in the midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. You.
Hi, guys. Thanks for joining us this Sunday morning, the second week of our Boiling Point series. We hope you were challenged by the Word of God and by the power of God's Spirit, and we hope that you'll join us next Sunday as we're continuing this series. Go out, love well this week.
love is kind. It's always present and it's better, it's better. Never knew a love like this. Never knew a love like this. Never knew a love like this. It's better, it's better.
Restored, it is your love, it is.
Your love is healing. Love is restored. Your love. Your love. Your love is healed. Every broken part. Your love restored.